Yo, what is up everybody? I'm FUTC and this is the Fujifilm X-Pro 1. The X-Pro 1 was Fujifilm's first proper entry into the market of mirrorless interchangeable lens cameras in 2012, over 10 years ago. Together with it came the debut of Fujifilm's first X-Trans sensor and the first X-mount lenses. While other companies like Nikon and Canon were still betting on DSLRs, Fujifilm decided to think outside the box with the camera that would ultimately shape the future of their mirrorless lineup. A very compact body compared to DSLRs of the time with vintage styling that fooled most people into believing that this might be an analog camera. And the rangefinder style viewfinder with some very unique tech. This lever in the front that looks like the self-release on an analog camera toggles the viewfinder between being optical and being electronic. With the optical viewfinder having an overlay to display information like settings, the focus point, and showing frame lines depending on the focal length of the attached lens. The idea being that a user can benefit from both the upsides of an optical and an electronic viewfinder depending on what is needed in a given situation. This hybrid viewfinder system is actually the main reason why I was looking into buying this camera, but it's actually not the first where Fujifilm implemented this. That was the original X100 released in 2011. So that means this is the second generation of that hybrid viewfinder system. And this unique tech came with a hefty price tag. On release, this was $1,700. I paid just $300. In Ken Rockwell's original review from 2012, he said that this is probably the best camera ever released for actual photographers. So how does this camera hold up over a decade later? To find out, I took it on a weekend trip to Hamburg to visit some family, and I took more photos than I can fit in this video. To be honest, I have so many sample images. Last Friday, I had my last exam of the semester, and directly after the exam, I sprinted to the next train, headed home, and then headed to Hamburg. I had like, I don't know, less than an hour time to pack all of my stuff, and luckily, the X-Pro 1 arrived in time for that trip. On our way there, we stopped for a quick pee break, and I met this dude with a light blue Nissan Silvia. I really like the aesthetic of old JDM cars, and this one was like peak JDM. And I was really happy that I found this guy. Poor guy, he was on the side of the road because he had motor issues, he was leaking oil, and he said he was having trouble and still had to go like a couple hundred kilometers. So yeah, poor guy, but at least I got some really nice shots out of it. I tried to edit these to like the analog 90s JDM vibe, and I think that works really well even with these out of focus shots, so yeah, let me know what you think. The next day was pretty uneventful photography wise. I basically just spent it all day eating cake and hanging out with my family. It was my grandpa's 90th birthday, and yeah, I just had a few shots that I took in between like the restaurant and the car. These shots were taken with the XC35mm f2. That was basically my most used lens on this trip, and it's generally my most used Fuji lens. I have a video on that I recently released. I have it somewhere here, I think. You know, like in the annotation thing. I hope that works. Sunday was the first real test of the X-Pro 1, and I spent pretty much all day taking photos. First, we got some food, then I spent some time walking around the area surrounding the main Hamburg train station for some architecture and street photography. I met up with my uncle, who knows a lot about Hamburg's buildings and architecture, and he showed me some really nice photo spots. We found a vantage point overlooking the whole city, and the sun was hitting exactly one piece of the train station between buildings. At this point, I had switched to the XC16-250 to give me a bit more range. The weather was constantly changing between rain and sunny blue skies, also both at the same time for some reason, giving me this photo I quite like. It started absolutely pouring, but the sun was still shining. I snapped this right before hiding the X-Pro 1 underneath my jacket so it doesn't get soaked. After that, I headed into a museum to catch up with my family. I didn't have much time before they closed, but I got this one photo I really like. This completely gray room with the purple light illuminating everything through the door and on the ground, it just works in my opinion. But I have to admit, the modern art section in this museum really wasn't my cup of tea. Sometimes I feel like modern art is just the artists laughing at us because they just made something and they're just watching the people trying to interpret any meaning into it. And it's just like one big prank by the artists. I don't know, modern art is... it's weird. I'm just out here looking at the art going, what does this mean? But the X-Trans 1 sensor in here holds up surprisingly well. Even at ISO 6400, the low light performance is really, really decent out of a 10-year-old camera. Compared to older DSLRs from that time, this is like miles ahead. And the 16 megapixel the X-Trans sensor has to offer is also more than enough in my opinion. At least there were some actual paintings in the museum as well, and while taking photos there I realized something about the viewfinder. I often go for symmetry and aligning things in my compositions, and with this offset viewfinder I was having a hard time doing that. Because this is offset by a few centimeters, I was just having a hard time knowing exactly when something is lined up or when something is symmetrical. I've used rangefinder systems before in analog cameras, but I've never really negatively noticed that I was having a hard time trying to line things up. Maybe I wasn't going for as much precision when shooting film. And one big factor probably also is that you're going to see the pictures a lot later when you're shooting film, because you're gonna get them back like 1 or 2 weeks later from the lab. And with digital, you have the results instantly, and you take a photo, and then you go, no wait, that's not what I wanted to do. For example, this shot that I took in the museum, I tried to get that whole top window in, but when I took the photo, I saw, no wait, this isn't at all what I wanted. And then I switched to the electronic viewfinder, and then I continued to get the composition that I wanted. Exposure is also a big factor, as you can see. The first shot I just showed was completely overexposed. Obviously, you can't properly judge the exposure through the optical viewfinder. With the EVF, you can exactly see what you're getting. In difficult lighting situations, it was pretty nice being able to switch to the EVF to better judge my exposure while shooting or when needing to look through the lens to exactly frame things as I wanted to. But that's where the X-Pro 1 and the hybrid viewfinder system really shines in my opinion. You can use the optical viewfinder when you want to go for speed and staying in the moment, and you can use the EVF when you're looking to get more precise compositions and you need to judge your exposure properly. Just a quick interruption here, I put a lot of work into these videos. Not only do I have to film and edit everything, I also have to go and take the actual photos and edit those and write the script for this video, which is like way too long, and that's just a huge amount of work, and there's so much time going into these videos, so any support from your side would be greatly appreciated. I'm not even gonna ask you to subscribe or like or anything. I really just want people to watch my videos to the end, because I put so much work into it, and sometimes it's a bit heartbreaking to see that only like 10 or 20% of the people watch these videos to the end. So yeah, maybe please watch to the end, okay? Upstairs there were tropical animals like different snakes and frogs, and there were a bunch of tropical plants everywhere. I really liked how these shots were turning out, especially the one of this huge snake. You can see the glass was reflecting two faces though, a pretty creepy detail in this photo once you realize it. When you go downstairs, there are several different aquariums, and I took some photos of fish. By the way, for all of these shots on this day, I was using the XC35 F2. There was one tank in particular that made for amazing photos. It had some jellyfish in it that just kept tumbling and twirling around, and there was some UV light shining on them. I was blown away by these images I got. After that, I already thought it couldn't get any better, but right around the next corner was this huge room with an absolutely massive window to an aquarium that had sharks and rays. I think I actually enjoyed taking photos of the people in front of the aquarium a lot more than taking photos of the fish inside of the aquarium. I don't know, it's like a street photography, wildlife, aquarium crossover episode, and I don't know, it just works. I'm so happy with these images. But the lighting was really difficult here, because the only light source pretty much came from the aquarium. Everything else was really, really dark, so I just used the electronic viewfinder for the whole time in the aquarium so I could properly judge my exposure. I have to say, the image quality of the X-Pro one delivers. It's really good considering this camera can be had for 300 bucks. I'm so happy with these images. They just look like these people are standing in an ocean and looking around in amazement. Seriously, people, go to an aquarium to take photos. It's actually photography on easy mode, I'm not kidding. Let's talk about the optical viewfinder. The overlay is interesting. You get the frame lines corresponding to the focal length of the lens you're using. When you're using a zoom lens, for example, you can see the frame lines change when zooming. There are two different viewfinder magnifications available, and the camera chooses between those depending on what lens you attach. The problem is, when I attach my 16-50, the camera chooses the wider magnification. This is great for shooting wide, but once you zoom in to 50mm, the frame lines are so tiny it's not really usable. The XC35 with the tighter magnification works really well though. So depending on what lens you're using, you will have to decide if it makes sense to use the optical viewfinder or not. On higher focal lengths, it's definitely not gonna make much sense to use the optical viewfinder because you just have like that tiny sliver of a frame line. The frame lines also compensate for the parallax effect once you have focused. You can see once I focus, the box moves to the right slightly. There are a lot of things I like about this camera, especially image quality was pretty surprising. But there are also a few things I'm not a big fan of. First of all, using manual lenses with these first generation Fuji X cameras is not a great experience. It feels like the focus peaking just adds a bit of sharpening and white edges around the parts that are in focus, but depending on the situation it can be extremely hard to see and makes manual focusing really difficult. Using manual lenses with the optical viewfinder is an even worse experience because there's basically no indication whatsoever what you're focused to, so yeah, your only option here is to zone focus. The second thing I don't like about this camera is that it's pretty slow. When you're taking several shots back to back, then it's gonna take a couple of seconds to write to the SD card until you can finally see the pictures, and the sensor readout really isn't that responsive, so when you're looking through the electronic viewfinder or through the screen and you're panning around, it just feels sluggish. The autofocus also isn't that great on this camera, especially in low light you're gonna have some difficulties sometimes, and the viewfinder blackout is also a bit annoying sometimes, but Fujifilm did a great job of mitigating these issues with the optical viewfinder because you don't have that slow sensor readout that doesn't matter because you're just looking through glass, and you don't have the problem of the viewfinder blackout when shooting. Basically, you can make this camera feel a lot faster when you're using the optical viewfinder. But of course you have to keep in mind that the perceived speed of this camera really is subjective. I've used a lot of different cameras and I have a more modern Fujifilm camera from 2019 and I just know that the sensor readout is a lot more responsive and it just feels quicker and snappier. But if you're coming from an older camera or this is your first camera, you're not gonna notice it. It's really subjective and it depends on what you're used to. But it doesn't really matter that this camera is slow because, as you can see, I got the shots anyways. It's always just a game of working within your limitations and working with what you have. And at this price point, it really doesn't matter. For 300 bucks, all of these nitpicky things I'm saying, they really don't matter. Because for 300 bucks, you really can't complain, and at this price point, I would always prioritize image quality over speed. The biggest problem I have with the X-Pro one is that my back dial is actually broken. I can't set the aperture at all, and I had to shoot this whole weekend with automatic aperture because, yeah, whenever I turn this, it just goes to like f22, f16, and then it just resets to automatic. I don't know, I'll just have to return this, I guess. Okay, let's sum up. The X-Pro 1 offers amazing image quality and surprisingly good low light performance in a super nice vintage body with great build quality. I thought a lot about the viewfinder because it was the biggest reason why I was curious to try the X-Pro 1. I think the hybrid viewfinder is a really good solution for those people that enjoy optical viewfinders, especially for street photography, it's really nice. And the option of switching to the electronic viewfinder or using the screen on the back in those situations where you need to more accurately judge your exposure and framing means you're not making any trade-offs. Depending on the situation, you can use whatever works best. The X-Pro 1 is not the fastest camera by any means, but the optical viewfinder is able to compensate for that a bit, and generally all of the negative points I've mentioned in this video are pretty nitpicky. In the end, at 300 bucks, this camera is an amazing value. It's fun to use, and most importantly, the image quality doesn't disappoint. The Fujifilm X-Mount also offers a good upgrade path, so if you start buying lenses for this camera, you can easily upgrade to a new Fuji camera down the line and keep using your lenses. I can recommend this camera to all people who want the optical viewfinder. To all other people who are either on an even tighter budget or are fine using an electronic viewfinder only, I would recommend getting the XE1. Simply because that can be had for 200 bucks and offers the same image quality and is a bit smaller because it doesn't have to fit the viewfinder assembly. I would put those extra 100 bucks towards the lens if you can live without the optical viewfinder. Thank you everybody for joining me today for this X-Pro 1 review. I'm really happy when people watch this far, like seriously, these videos take a lot of work, and when people watch this far, it means a lot to me, so really, thank you. Subscribe to the channel if you're interested in more videos like this, and maybe like this video if you liked it. And I have more videos here and here, and my Instagram is at futc.photography. I have a bunch of photos there from past trips and past videos, and yeah, that's basically it. See you in the next one, bye bye. Thank you.